HarperTeen and Harper Audio present The Cerulean by Amy Ewing, performed by Kim Mai Guest. Part 1. The City Above the Sky. 1. We are the Cerulean. Our blood is magic. Sarah's mothers had told her this since the day she was born, before she could speak or think or understand what it meant. Every Cerulean child knew there was magic in their blood. It had healing powers for one, and it could form the most intimate connection of the blood bond. None of that magic was helping Sera today, though. The Cloud Spinner's Grove was cold, the only place in the city above the sky that wasn't perfectly temperate. Grass crunched under her bare feet as she reached to grab a fistful of clouds from where they clung, delicate as a spider's web, to the black leaves of the nebula tree. The thin strands were slippery and floated up to a higher leaf, out of Sarah's reach. "Drat!" she cursed, and a couple of girls closest to her gasped. Corrine shot her a discerning look, then tossed her bright blue hair over one shoulder, spinning her cloud into the most delicate thread, as if to show Sarah how it was really done. Sarah looked down at her own cloud-spun dress, the one her green mother had made for her, and knew she would never be able to spin enough clouds to make one herself.
"Don't try to catch them," Leela said, getting up from her wheel, where she already had a thick spool of spun thread ready to be woven into fabric. "Let them come to you."
"That's easy for you to say," Sera said. "We've been working in the grove for 3 weeks, and I'm no better at cloud spinning now than I was then."
"We'll be moving on to the Star Gem mines soon," Leela said. "Perhaps you'll find your calling there."
Leela was Sarah's best friend, her only friend, really. She didn't seem to mind Sarah's outbursts or endless questions, or the way Sera liked to laugh so big and loud she could scare the birds in the aviary. She was looking so hopeful now that Sera couldn't bring herself to say that she didn't think she was meant to hunt for precious jewels in the mines either. She wasn't sure what her purpose in the city was supposed to be. And she was turning 18 soon, an adult. She feared the High Priestess might simply assign her to the temple to be a novice because she wouldn't know what else to do with her. And Sera couldn't think of anything she'd rather do less. She loved Mother Sun, of course, but she didn't see the need to sing songs about her and clean the temple all day just to prove that. But it had been a year since her lessons with her green mother had ended, and she and the other young Cerulean had begun learning the various trades of the city above the sky. She knew her green mother had been hoping she'd take to cloud spinning. It had been her occupation before Sera was born, and she had spun all of Sera's dresses. Her orange mother would love if she became a novice, but Sera had a suspicion that she knew better than to hope for that, based on Sarah's consistent tardiness to evening prayers. Her purple mother played the most beautiful music on the miniature harp. She was always asked to play at festivals and celebrations, but Sera had no musical talent whatsoever, and her purple mother had understood this early on and never pressed her. She was too boisterous for the aviary. She got bored and distracted while overseeing the sear sheep in the meadow. She was too impatient to tend to the bees in the apiary.
"Perhaps Sera will be the first Cerulean with no true calling at all," Corrine said, in a tone that was at once honey-sweet and laced with tartness. Trina and Dana exchanged a glance. Dana had already found her calling to help care for the orchards and had received a blessing from the High Priestess. She would begin her work there soon. Sera was fairly certain Trina would be asking for a blessing to work with the midwives any day now.
Of course she will find a calling, Leela said brusquely.
She hasn't yet, Dana pointed out.
Neither have I, Leela shot back.
Yes, but I would like to tend to the tether, Sera said.
She didn't know where the words came from, but once they were out, she knew they were true.
The other girls stared at her as though she had just sprouted an extra head.
The tether? Elorin gasped. No one tends to the tether, Corrine scoffed. It hasn't needed tending in years and years. That was the whole point of attaching our city to that planet down there in the first place.
The city above the sky wasn't like the many planets of the universe. It was not a planet at all. It wasn't round like a ball, but flat, a floating oval disk with a temple in its center and two sprawling gardens at either end. A fine membrane of magic protected its outer rim and encased it like an egg, securing its edges so no mindless Cerulean would wander off it and fall into space. Since it had no rain or snow or any discernible weather, the city must attach itself to a planet by means of a tether, a tangible, finely wrought chain of magic in links of gold and silver and blue, invisible to the human eye, but perfectly visible to every Cerulean. This tether gave the city life. It drew nutrients up from the planet, minerals and molecules of all kinds, the way grass draws water up from soil. It kept the great estuary full and the orchards watered. It kept the air pure and the animals healthy. Sarah's green mother had told her of how dangerous the journey to this planet had been nearly 900 years ago after the great sadness had happened and Cerulean life had changed irrevocably. It had taken so long to find the green, blue, brown orb below. The estuary had nearly dried up, and the moonflower fields had withered and blown away, and the seer sheep had begun to die.
How can we be sure the tether is still healthy? Sera said to Corrine. My green mother told me that there used to be Cerulean who would look after it and warn the High Priestess when it was time for the city to move again. Our city used to move all the time, didn't it? And now we've been stuck here for almost a millennium.
Because Mother's son gave us a great gift, Elorin said piously.
Elorin would definitely end up as a novice.
This planet has so many resources to share, we need not move at all.
But we're meant to move, aren't we? Sera said. In all the oldest stories, the Cerulean would move from planet to planet, sometimes even twice in 1 year.
I don't know what your green mother has been teaching you, Corrine said. But mine has never said anything about any Cerulean tending to the tether.
All green mothers were educators, imparting to their daughters the history and stories of the Cerulean people, passed down from generation to generation. The Cerulean had no books or written language, just the symbols on the temple doors, the language of Mother's son that only the High Priestess could read.
Maybe that's because you never asked, Sera muttered.
Not to mention the fact that we are safe here, Corrine continued. What if we go searching for another planet and can't find one? What if we move and there is another great sadness? Is that what you want, Sera?
She felt stung. Of course not. The great sadness had happened on the last planet the city had been attached to. It was the single worst tragedy in Cerulean history. 200 Cerulean had been murdered by the humans who lived on the planet,
and the city had been forced to move before its time. Sera would never want that to happen again. She loved her city. She truly did. She just felt a bit bored sometimes. She had become so familiar with the planet beneath them, the shapes of its two countries, Kaolin and Pelago, etched into her brain. She could probably draw them in her sleep. Kaolin was a hulking swath of land, shaped like a lopsided star, Pelago a myriad of islands. Besides, she had already gleaned every scrap of information about them that she could from her green mother, who could only tell her what her green mother had taught her, and so on and so on. Sera always wondered what stories might have been lost or changed over the generations. For now, she felt there was nothing left to learn. As long as they were attached to this planet, the tether was the only mystery that remained to her. She could see it from the edges of the city, the fine bluish silvery gold line cutting through the darkness of space. She wondered what it looked like where it stuck into the underside of the city, if it attached like a spiderweb, or simply thrust out proudly from the city's belly. Corrine smiled smugly and changed the subject. "Anyway, my orange mother told me something in confidence last night." The other girls leaned in, eager to hear what Corrine had to say. Leela rolled her eyes, and Sera suppressed a giggle. "There will be a wedding season soon." There were squeals of delight and clapping of hands at this proclamation, and Sera couldn't help joining in. She had not yet lived through a wedding season and had always wanted to see one.
"When? Are you sure? Oh, this is so exciting."
"The High Priestess mentioned it at her prayer group," Corrine said, pushing her hair back again. Every Cerulean had skin as silvery as moonlight, and blue hair and blue eyes that matched the color of their blood. But for some reason, it all looked better on Corrine than on Sera. Sera didn't like looking at herself in the one mirror in her house. She felt like her skin was a lie, hiding a secret even Leela didn't know.
"I've been waiting for a wedding season my whole life," Trina said. "Imagine the dresses."
"Imagine the food," Sera said with a grin that Trina returned.
"How many triads will be married, do you think?"
Eloran asked.
"How many do you think will form in advance of the season?" Dana said with a mischievous look.
"Come now," Leela said. "Marriage is sacred. Mother's son would not allow a triad to marry if they were not truly in love."
Dana shrugged, but did not look convinced. The girls chattered on about who would be marrying and which in the newly formed triads would be the purple or green or orange mother, and what flowers they would use to make garlands for their hair, and whether they would finally get their first taste of sweet nectar and feel its heady effects. As the conversation wore on, Sera turned to her spinning wheel and picked up a clump of unusable thread.
"I'm not going to tell Green Mother about this," she said with a sigh. "She'll only be disappointed."
"Your green mother wants you to be happy," Leela said. "She just has more time on her hands, now that you are not pelting her with questions from morning until night."
Sera laughed. "I was a difficult pupil, wasn't I?"
"Your green mother is a very patient woman."
Sera dropped the clump of cloud onto the frosty grass. The oldest stories said the nebula trees had come from one of the first planets the city above the sky had tethered itself to, long before Sera or her mother's mothers were born. Someplace cold and dark and full of mystery. That was another part of the magic of the tether. It could grow little pieces of whatever planet it was connected to in the city above.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.